mean one, Mr. Grinch. You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus, you're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch. You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel. You're a monster, Mr. Grinch. Your heart's an empty hole. Your brain is full of spiders. You've got garlic in your soul, Mr. Grinch. I wouldn't touch you with a 39 and a half foot pole. You're a vile one, Mr. Grinch. You have termites in your smile.
The Grinch is a mean dude. Also, real quick, shout out to my kids for having to put up with that, because this is pastor's kid life sometimes. When dad says you have to be in a video, which means, dad, I mean, Grinch gets to tackle you, you deal with that. And so it's the Christmas season, though. I'm excited about it. I love Christmas. How many of you guys love this time of year? A few of you. How many of you guys are like, I'm ready for this season to be over? Couple more. Yeah, that's fine. That's fair. There's a mixture of both. That's okay. I enjoy the Christmas season as long as it's after Thanksgiving. Like, I'm a pretty Grinch guy about that. Like, before Thanksgiving, let's chill out with that stuff. After, let's have fun. The music, the decorations. We put up our tree and decorated that this weekend. It's a good time. But I also love Christmas movies. Like, I am a huge fan of Christmas movies. Christmas Vacation is by far the best and my favorite. I can't wait to watch that this year. But one of my favorites, I love Home Alone, Elf, but I love the Grinch too. I'm a huge fan of the Grinch. The cartoon version or the live action, that new animated one that came out a couple years ago, I can do without that. But you know, the cartoon, the Jim Carrey one, I love them. And if you're not familiar with the story, because you've been living under a rock your whole life, here's what the Grinch is all about. It's a story of a green creature called the Grinch who hates Christmas and hates the Whos who live in Whoville who love Christmas. And because he hates them, and part of the reason is his heart is two sizes too small. He doesn't have the capacity to love Christmas and other people. And so he wants to steal their joy by stealing Christmas. And he has this whole thing planned out to go on Christmas Eve to go steal Christmas, all their food, the decorations, the presents. He steals it, wants to take their joy away. And it's a great story, great movie, something we watch. We watch both the cartoon and the live action every year together as a family. And it's great. But honestly, there's a lot of people who can be Grinches in our lives, right? People who can steal our joy. People who can take away our joy this time of year, like this guy in 2012. His name is Nate Trimmer. Some people laughing are family with Nate. They know what I'm about to talk about. In 2012, now Nate's a great guy. He's Danielle's cousin. And at Christmas time, their side of the family would all come together for big Christmas traditions and holidays and gatherings. Until 2012, when what happened was Nate got sick. And Nate didn't get like, you know, cold sniffle sick. He got achy fever coming out of both ends type sick. It was miserable. And the worst part was it was contagious. And so he gets this sickness, and I see Nate get it, and I see, you know, other family members getting it. And you ever be in a situation kind of like we are in now where other people are getting sick, and you're like, okay, am I going to get this? Like, what am I supposed to do right now? It's contagious. Stay away from it, whatever. And I start to get worried because, as most guys do, I'm horrible at being sick. Like, if I get a cold, like, I'm on my deathbed. Like, it just doesn't go well. But I see all these other people start to get sick, and I'm like, it's coming for me. It's going to hit me. I'm avoiding it at all costs. It's not good. So we get through Christmas Eve. We get through Christmas. We get through the 26th, and Danielle gets sick, the 26th into the 27th, which is my birthday. So selfish me gets angry having to take care of my sick wife on my birthday, but I'm like, maybe I won't get it. Now, we're days through this. I haven't gotten sick yet. I've been around Nate and everybody else. Maybe I'm okay. Okay, but then the night of my birthday, that 27th, I get it. And I'm miserable for the next few days after that. And all in all, 10 people get the Trimmer plague that Christmas season, all because of that Grinch Nate. He started it. And there wasn't much joy that Christmas. It just wasn't fun. It wasn't joyful. Everyone was sick or waiting to get sick. And the thing is, we have people in our lives that can take away that joy. Now, sometimes it's funny that we look back on the Trimmer plague. Nate, he ruined everything. It's all good. We love him still. But there's other things that can steal our joy at Christmas time. people who cause us stress and anxiety, people who are not a joy to be around. Sometimes there's circumstances that can take away our joy at Christmas, like COVID right now, changing our plans, canceling plans, keeping us from people potentially. Sometimes Grinches in our lives can be humorous, like the people who the Grinches who give really bad gifts at Christmas. You guys know who they are, right? Like the aunt or the, you know, the crazy, someone's pointing at somebody else right now. That's the whole little marital thing they got to deal with themselves. I'm just kidding. But sometimes, you know, people who give bad gifts, we can laugh that off, but they can be Grinches, steal our joy. But other times, there are Grinches in our lives that can hurt. They can hurt us. Maybe there's a bad history with the relationship with them. Maybe it's people who have caused pain in our lives. Maybe it's someone who is hurting themselves, and they're projecting that hurt onto other people for whatever reason that may be. Maybe there's someone who stole your innocence when you were younger. People in our lives who steal joy. And the truth is, we don't like that. We don't want that this season, right? We don't want people to steal our joy at Christmas time. We want this season to be a season of celebration of the goodness of God's work in Jesus, his birth. This is what we should be focusing on and celebrating together as a people of following Jesus. And we don't want people to take that from us, but this whole season is all about us getting focused on Jesus, but the Grinches can easily get us distracted. So what do we do about those Grinches? And this is the whole point of this series. In the midst of everything going on, as stressful as this year has been, we still have to deal with people who could potentially distract us and take our joy away from Jesus. We need to know what to do about that. So the tension is, what do I do about the Grinches in my life? That's how we're kicking off this series. And it starts with this first principle. And the first principle is this. In order to deal with the Grinches in my life, I must admit that I too am a Grinch. I want us to say it together because this is an important one, okay? So follow along with me, okay? With me. In order to deal with the Grinches in my life, I must admit that I too am a Grinch. You know, the first step is admitting you have a problem, right? And the problem is all of us can be a Grinch. And if I'm honest, I can be the worst Grinch in my life. My anger can steal joy from people for sure. Ask my kids. My strong opinions can steal joy from people. And the truth is all of us can steal joy from others. All of us can be a Grinch. And to dig into this more, I want to look at Jesus's teaching on the Sermon on the Mount. This is his most famous teaching. And when he teaches this thing in Matthew 5 through 7, the main idea what he's getting at is this. He's not saying, here's how we fix the world. What he's really getting at the Sermon on the Mount, he's saying this, here's how I want to fix you. And if we read the Sermon on the Mount with that mentality, here's how God wants to transform my life, it changes things. And this is what Jesus is doing in this. And at the end, towards the end of his teaching in Matthew 7, we come to this in verses 1 and 2. He says, do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Now, a lot of us, I think, whether we have a faith background or not, we've heard this before. And we love to quote this. Christians and non-Christians alike like to quote, don't judge. Jesus says, don't judge. And we read that in scripture and go, okay, well, Jesus, he did say that. He said, don't judge others. So maybe I shouldn't judge others. What does that look like? But the truth is, this doesn't mean, I think, a lot of times what we think it means. You know, there is evidence that we should call people out for their sin, their brokenness, their hypocrisy, all those different things. What he's saying is, he says, don't judge in the sense of slamming the gavel down on someone's life. Of saying, you know, this person is without hope. This person is unforgivable. We don't judge in that type of way. That's not what we do. That is God's right to do, not us. He does talk about at other times, we do call people out for behavioral problems, hypocrisy, and sin. Jesus did that himself. His followers do that, and they especially did it among each other as followers. As Christians, we should call each other out for our sin and our hypocrisy and our behavioral problems. So when the Grinch, and then there's a Grinch who's stealing joy in our lives, we can and should call them out for that, but not without following what comes next and what Jesus teaches. He says, don't judge or you'll be judged. The way you measure, it'll be measured against you. Then he continues by saying, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? Now, I think a lot of times we think of Jesus as this quiet, pious teacher. You know, he's very righteous and teaches, you know, these things about, you know, God, and he's holy. But sometimes we miss, because of translations and reading the Bible, that Jesus was actually a really funny dude. Like, he had jokes, and we don't see it as easily in our translation, but when he would have said this, he would have made the crowd laugh with hysterics. Like he dropped this exaggeration of, listen, you're so worried about a little tiny speck in your brother's eye when you have a giant piece of wood sticking out of your own eye. And what happens is, listen, you're so focused on other people's problems that you ignore your own. And we put blame on others for stealing our joy and miss the fact that we can steal it ourselves. And Jesus is explaining this and teaching this, that we have to deal with our own before we worry about other people's. And he continues in verse 5. He says, "You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." And he calls them hypocrites. Now, how many of you guys love being called a hypocrite? Right? I mean, Jesus just lays it out to the crowd right now. It's like, "You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye." This is the truth, though. When we focus on other people's problems, we ignore our own. We ignore our own sin, and we become hypocrites. We want to call others the Grinch in our lives, but in reality, we're the Grinch ourselves, and we steal joy from ourselves. We steal it from other people, and we definitely need to deal with our own Grinchiness, which I think a word is, I just made up that word, but I'm going to go with it, our own Grinchiness in our own lives before we worry about other people's and theirs. And this is the principle that we need to look at today in this season and moving forward, because we can be the biggest joy thieves at Christmas time. We don't just steal it from others, we steal it from ourselves. And I mean, think about it. Do you know someone who is miserable in their lives because they just make themselves miserable? Everything is just a problem. They complain about everything. Everything is just an issue. And because of that, they make themselves miserable. And so they make other people miserable too. This is an issue we all can deal with, and we need to do something about it. So here's a practical step I want to encourage us to take. The first I want to talk about is this, is we need to put down the magnifying glass and pick up the mirror. I mean, think about this concept of the idea of putting down a magnifying glass and picking up a mirror. We need to not focus so much on other people's actions, but look at ourselves. You see, from the very beginning, we see our sinful nature cause us to point the finger and blame others. I mentioned this last week. I'll mention it again. In the Garden of Eden, after Adam and Eve sinned, when God called them out for it, what Adam did was this. He pointed his finger at Eve and said, "God, this woman you put here with me, she made me do it." No, dude, she did not make you take the fruit and chew it and swallow it. You did that by yourself. But we look for ways to blame other people. We have to put the magnifying glass down and pick up the mirror. But this is what we do in our culture, right? We like to blame others. We like to pinpoint their mistakes and their brokenness. We put up the magnifying glass on their lives. We blame the Democrats or the Republicans for the mess we're in. We say things like, "This is how we're supposed to handle COVID," and people are divided on it, and it causes issues. Like, even at Thanksgiving, we're going to deal with it for Christmas too. We had the issue of stay home, gather with family. That tension that was woven throughout the narrative, it was very difficult to deal with. And the thing is, this was not a black and white issue. This was very gray, and it wasn't as easy as just stay home and don't do anything, or don't see family, or go see family. It was difficult. And people were projecting their thoughts and their blame on others. And I want to encourage us, forget the outside world. I'm just talking to us as one church right now. We need to be careful with what we project on other people, because we can have our convictions. We can have our beliefs about how we deal with what we're dealing with right now, and that is fine. We also have to make sure that we have to realize this is not a black and white situation. There's gray in it. It is not simple to deal with. And as Christians, we have to be careful about that, because it's very easy for us to get in these situations and start calling people out for their mess ups. And this is the speck and the plank situation. That where there might be an issue for them, we have our own issues that we're not dealing with ourselves. So be careful with that. Be careful with what we're projecting on other people. We do that easily. Think about social media right now. It's a cesspool to begin with, but you go onto social media and Facebook and Twitter and things like that. Do you think people are working and posting with a mirror in mind or a magnifying glass? It's very much a magnifying glass, blaming other people for their problems. Think about, you know, maybe disputes and fights you have with your spouse or significant other. Do you spend most of your time with a mirror in mind or a magnifying glass? I know I can confess that sometimes I like to do the whole magnifying glass thing, because I don't like losing. And so that can cause problems in our relationships. But what are we doing, magnifying glass or mirror? You see, when it's a magnifying glass, we can easily steal joy from other people. There's a situation in Jesus' life in John 8, 1 through 11, where John writes and records about this time where Jesus was showing he's all about the mirror over the magnifying glass. And the Sermon on the Mount was all about looking at ourselves rather than others. And in this situation, this woman is caught in adultery. Now, I have no idea the background. Maybe she was in the middle of committing adultery with this man, and these religious leaders take her and drag her to Jesus. And they throw her at Jesus' feet and say, "Listen, Jesus, this woman was caught in adultery." Now, one little caveat, the question I have is, where's the guy in this situation? Like, there's another piece of this, you know, adultery going on, but they just drag the woman out to Jesus and go, "Hey, Jesus, what do you do with her? Because based off the law, she should be stoned to death." And they weren't wrong about that. And so Jesus takes the situation, he sees it, and he says this. He goes, "Whoever is without sin, you cast the first stone." And these religious leaders who are obviously now looking at themselves and looking at themselves in the mirror because Jesus forces them to, they start dropping the stones. And they start walking away because none of them are faultless and pure to actually judge and condemn this woman. And after they all walk away, the only person who has the right to throw a stone is Jesus. And he goes up to her and goes, "Where are your accusers? Did no one condemn you?" And she replied, said, "No one." And he replies, "Neither do I. Now go and leave your life of sin." See, the one who actually had the right to condemn her didn't. I mean, that's the beauty of what we can celebrate at Christmas, right? Is the one who was born, who had the power to condemn us, came to save us, to rescue us, to forgive us. And this woman experienced it because Jesus forced them to look at the mirror and not the magnifying glass. And we need to do that, especially right now in our culture. Mirror over magnifying glass. And when we do that, we can start self-examining. And so here's the question: what's your plank? We can worry about the speck in other people's eyes all day long. What's the plank in yours? What's the struggle in yours? What's the thing in your life that is causing you to steal joy from yourself and other people? Is it greed? I mean, that's an easy one to look at this year, this desire for more, more money, more stuff. The world gave $449 billion in 2019, in the whole year, which is a 5% increase from 2018, which is really good, right? I'm like, cool, we went up 5%. We gave more money to charities and donated more things to help people. That's awesome. But let's look at this. Black Friday spending this year, we spent $9 billion, which was up 21% from the year before. You see, we give more, but our consumerism is far outpacing our generosity because we have this mentality of consumerism and we want more stuff. What this does is when we continue to chase those things, it steals our joy. Now, listen, I'm not saying this Christmas season don't buy gifts. Maybe that's a decision you have to make, but I'm not saying don't buy gifts because gifts are fun. Gifts are great. I love giving gifts. I love getting gifts. Like, it's a good time because it shows love. It shows relationships. It shows, you know, this thoughtfulness. There's importance with that. What I'm saying is our consumerism can cause us to steal joy from ourselves and other people. We have to pay attention to that. I'm also not calling you greedy. That's not my place to call you that. But maybe if you have to self-examine and bring up the mirror, maybe that is your plank. It's greed. Or maybe your plank is something more emotional, like loneliness, where there is something going on where, you know, there's difficult things going on. Maybe there's relationships that are broken, relationships that are missing, and that's leading you to become frustrated and bitter towards other people, and it can cause you to become more of a recluse and avoid people. Loneliness can be a very real and painful thing. As I think of my father this time of the year, always. Some of you guys know, some of you don't. I have a very strained relationship with my dad. He was an addict, and our family broke apart, and we don't talk to him a lot, but he's by himself. I know this season weighs heavy on him, and it's a very difficult thing for him to go through, and it's really hard to even navigate, but in that, it can cause him to be kind of a Grinch in me and my family's life. Loneliness can be a plank. This is why we individuals have to get to the birth at Christmas, because at Christmas, we see hope born. We see hope manifests itself through God sending himself as Jesus, his son, to come and rescue us and redeem us. This is where hope comes from. We have to get to Jesus. Maybe your plank is none of those. Maybe it's anger. Maybe this is anger. This is personal for me. The holidays can be very stressful. You know the whole line in the Christmas song, it's the most wonderful time of the year? That's a lie. Like last night after we finished like decorating the Christmas tree, all three boys just went on this fit for some reason. I don't know what, they were just angry at each other. They were yelling, they were screaming. Drew was complaining. Kobe was crying. Noah was just sitting there instigating it all. And Danielle's trying to, you know, talk to them as a parent. I'm just sitting back literally thinking, yeah, the most wonderful time of year. Yeah, right. This is horrible. But we buy gifts, and to buy gifts, we go into debt. Kids don't listen. We try to navigate the holidays in a pandemic. People's expectations of you are so high, and you put pressure on yourself to meet those expectations. And all these things build up over the holiday season, and it just leads to you kind of bursting out in anger, right? No, just me? Okay, cool. That's what I do then. This is what you do. You lash out with anger. Do you lose patience? Does your voice go up, or do your words become sharp? This is often my plank, especially with my family. And I can steal joy. And I can become that Grinch. And when I do that, what I'm doing here is I am distracting my family from seeing Jesus this holiday season. Maybe your plank is jealousy. Or maybe it's bitterness. Maybe it's hate. What is your plank right now? What is causing you to steal joy from others? What is causing you to distract others from Jesus? Recognize what that is and have this hope that Jesus can set you free from that. You see, the point of Christmas is the hope that it brings, that it's God with us. When the angels announce that, you know, Emmanuel is born, Emmanuel means that God is with us. Jesus is with us. There's not some distance between us and God anymore. The hope of Christmas is that God came to us through this humble birth, and we cannot miss that. We cannot miss it, especially this year. We cannot miss the birth of Jesus. We have to get to that moment so we can have that hope. And to do that, it comes with us, you know, putting down the magnifying glass and picking up the mirror. Because often what happens at Christmas time is we get so distracted with everything going on. We do a million things at Christmas time in the holiday season that we miss Jesus. We do shopping and presents and planning and stress and decorations. And we do, oh yeah, Jesus was born. That's great. And then we do the meals, the plans, the family, the exhaustion, the letdown. Then we pack it all up to do it all again next year, right? I mean, this is the same thing we do over and over and over again. This is not the most wonderful time of the year. And the main culprit of this is not the presents. The main culprit of us missing Jesus at Christmas time is not COVID. It's not whatever Starbucks Christmas cup design is. I always love that people get worked up about that every year, especially Christians. What are we doing? Like, it's a red and green cup with some decorations on it that held your coffee. Let's relax a little bit, okay? That's not the reason we miss Christmas. They're not stealing Jesus out of Christmas. No one can do that. No one has the power to do that. The culprit is not other people's attitudes and actions that causes to miss Jesus at Christmas. The main culprit is ourselves. Because in the chaos of the season, we often don't get to Jesus. And my challenge for us is we've got to get there this year. In the midst of this whole year that we went through, and this year's been hell, we've got to get to Jesus. And the one thing we need to walk away with is the birth of Jesus should lead me to give joy, not steal it. It's Jesus who frees us from all of this, but we have to trust that and live out that hope. We have to get there this season. We have to look at Christmas as a reminder that it's not Jesus rescue them, it's Jesus rescue me. It's Jesus rescue me. It's Jesus who frees us from our greed and gives us contentment. It's Jesus who frees us from loneliness and gives us community. It's Jesus who frees us from our anger and gives us joy. It's Jesus that takes the grinchiest of Grinches and makes us sons and daughters of God. You see, Christmas isn't about getting angry at the Grinches around us. It's about asking Jesus to transform ourselves to bring joy to the world. And if you want joy and contentment this season, it's more about what Jesus is doing in you rather than what other people are doing. It's not about letting other Grinches steal our joy. It's making sure we recognize and get to Jesus this Christmas for what he's doing in us. The best part about the Grinch movie is at the end, after he steals Christmas. He does it. It was masterful. He got Max to be his reindeer. He sneaks in. He goes and steals the presents, the decorations, the food, everything. And he takes it, and he's about to throw all this stuff over the mountain, and Christmas morning hits, and what happens? The Who's come out, despite losing all their stuff, and they start singing their Christmas song. And the Grinch realizes it doesn't matter what he did, he can't steal Christmas from them. And in that moment, what happens? That two sizes too small heart grows three sizes. It's an overgrown heart of joy and redemption. And this is what Jesus does to us. He gives us this new heart. Because the truth is, no one else can steal Christmas from us if we don't let them. No matter what this season throws us, no matter what the Grinch is doing in our lives, doesn't take Christmas from us, doesn't take Jesus from us. Because Jesus gives us that new heart. And this is what we need, a new heart. One that doesn't worry about others' actions, but looks to love God and serve other people. And so there are three action steps I'm going to encourage you guys to live out, all of us, not just you, me too, this Christmas season, to make sure that we don't steal Christmas from ourselves or other people. The first is this: I'm encouraging all of us to seek Jesus this Christmas. Seek him out. We need to get to the birth of Jesus. We need to get to that hope. And we do that by, gathering for church on Sunday mornings in person or online, but also throughout the week. My encouragement to you is maybe pick a reading plan. Go to the YouVersion Bible app on your phone. If you don't have that, download it. Pick any Christmas reading plan you want. Just pick one and read it. Spend time reflecting on Jesus at Christmas time this year. Reading plans, pray. Do something to make sure you're seeking Jesus out this Christmas. The second thing I'm going to encourage you to do is give generously this season. Giving over getting. Give generously. And here's what I'm going to encourage you to do. A couple things. One, I'll encourage you to give generously to One Church this year. Because here's the deal. With us buying a building, there's a lot of stuff we want to do with this building. There's closing costs that we didn't have just money sitting in a bank account. Oh, here's closing costs. Let's just, that's what it's for. I'm going to encourage you to give generously to One Church this year as a way to help us purchase the building and continue to pay down the principal when all that stuff happens, to do some of the renovations we want to do, because this room's going to get totally changed. Help us do that by giving generously this year. But here's the thing. If giving money to One Church is an issue, and I understand that can be an issue sometimes, that's fine. I still want to encourage you to give generously this season. Pick a charity that means a lot to you and give to them. Take care of foster kids like Foster Love is doing. Help the homeless, whatever that may be. Give generously to help bring joy to other people's lives this year. Do something to give generously this year. And here's what I'm also encouraging you. If you have kids, include them in this. Have conversations about that with them. Help them decide where money goes. I mean, it's kind of risky, but do that. Make sure they see this practice of generosity, because, listen, as kids, they're pumped about the presents at Christmas time, right? Which is fine. Like, my mother-in-law, she gave the kids an iPad at Thanksgiving. Like, all right, guys, start building up your Christmas list. And Noah was actually pretty conservative. Drew and Kobe, my goodness, they had like $600 worth of stuff in the shopping cart before this was all said and done. Like, this is what they do, those selfish little kids. Some people's kids, I tell you. But they're excited about it, but they need to see the heart of generosity. Because when you show kids the heart of generosity, you're showing them the heart of God. Include them in this. Give generously. And the last thing I want to invite you guys to do is invite others to get to Jesus with you this year. You have friends, family members, coworkers that they're getting distracted by the grinchiness of the season too. But you can be someone that gives them joy by inviting them to get to Jesus this year. Do that by loving them, by serving them, giving them gifts. I also invite you to invite them to join you for Sunday services at One Church, whether in person or online. Host a watch party online and invite people to join you this Christmas season. Invite them to Christmas Eve. Now, one of the things I was really pumped about hoping this year that we could have like an in-person big Christmas Eve gathering, but with everything going on, it's just kind of difficult to plan out and figure out. So here's what we're doing. We are creating an online Christmas Eve experience that's going to premiere at different times over December 23rd and 24th, because I know all of our holiday schedules are crazy. Sometimes we have stuff going on the 23rd, sometimes the 24th, and so it's like sometimes we put the one Christmas Eve service, not many people can get to it, so we're like, here's multiple opportunities. We're going to announce those times this next week. Pick one of the times for you and your family to say, this is our Christmas Eve gathering. And you sit down together at home around a meal and watch it and engage in it. Invite people to join you with that, but invite people to meet Jesus this year. Because there's a lot of distractions that can pull us away from the birth of Jesus. Let's make sure we're not the ones stealing that from others. Let's make sure we're the ones getting people to that joy of Christmas. Let's give joy this year. Let's not steal it. So what's going to happen is we need to focus this season on what really matters, and that's Jesus Christ. And we need to look at our own lives and make sure we're not the Grinches stealing that joy from others. That we are realizing those planks in our own lives, we need to get rid of them. Jesus can free us from that. It can help us experience the joy that we so desperately need at Christmas. The beauty of our faith is we get to this point called Easter, which is months from now, but we'll get there. This point of Jesus laying down his life so we can be forgiven, rescued, redeemed, and given eternity with God both now and forever, but that doesn't get there without Christmas. So what's going to happen? I'm going to pray. We're going to sing. And I'm going to come back up and we'll end our time with communion. If you didn't grab your communion in the back, do so. If you're at home watching online, make sure you grab your communion over this next song. Let's worship together. And then we'll gather to close out our service to take communion together to remember this is why we celebrate this season, because it leads us to the greatest gift God's ever given us. That's himself through his son, Jesus. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for today. God, thank you for this church, these amazing people and friends that we share this community with, God. God, thank you for this season. God, this season can come with a lot of distractions and frustrations and Grinches, and God, we just pray that we're not the biggest Grinch in our own lives. That we don't steal joy from others and ourselves, that we give joy because of who you are. And we celebrate the birth of your son, and we let that lead us this season, not what other people do, but we let the truth of your mercy and grace through the birth of Jesus impact us and transform us, and not let other people get us away from that. God, help us to get to you this season. Help us to seek you out, to be generous, and to help others get to you at Christmas. Thank you for coming to us through your son. In your name we pray.